Thank you for downloading this Council on Foreign Relations video. CFR is an independent national membership organization and nonpartisan research center. For more information, please visit us online at cfr.org.
I'm Jim Lindsay, Director of Studies and Vice President here at the Council. It's my great pleasure and honor to welcome you all here today to the Council on Foreign Relations Symposium on Organized Crime in the Western Hemisphere, an Overlooked Threat. We are holding today's symposium in collaboration with the Latin American Program and the Mexico Institute of the Woodrow Wilson Center. Dr. Andrew Seeley, Director of Latin American Program, is here, and I want to just say thank you to Andrew and his organization for agreeing to co-sponsor this symposium. What I would like to do, and it's of course always important to note that we can't do the sort of program we do here at the Council without the support and generosity of a number of people who I'd like to just mention right here. First is Rita Hauser. Rita Hauser is here in the front row. Rita has been a generous supporter of the Council over the years and has given us a gift that makes it possible for us to engage in these sort of annual conferences where we reach out and collaborate with another think tank, and it's been an important contribution to the Council. I want to say thank you very much, Rita. Second, where today's event is made possible by the Tinker Foundation, which has supported our work in Latin America, and I believe Nancy Truitt is somewhere in the room, a senior advisor to the Tinker Administration Foundation, but perhaps I got it wrong. Last, I want to thank the Robina Foundation, which has underwritten the Council's brand new initiative on international institutions and global governance, which has been an effort to try to look at international institutions as they exist at the beginning of the 21st century and try to devise more effective avenues for promoting multilateral cooperation. What brings us here today for discussion is based on the observation that the illicit flow of goods, money, information, and people is an increasing source of tension in relations between the developed countries and developing countries. Nowhere is this more true than in the Western Hemisphere. Latin America is a major source of cocaine and many other illegal substances for the U.S. market as well as for Europe. And the problems created by the drug trade are increasingly coming to dominate U.S. hemispheric relations. Within the hemisphere, Mexico has emerged as the newest power center for organized crime. A couple of decades ago, Mexico is largely viewed as a transit country for illegal drugs from Colombia. Today, Mexican drug trafficking organizations now are a major player of their own. They are a major presence in source countries such as Bolivia and Colombia. They control supply routes through Central America, and they control drug distribution rings here in the United States. Indeed, the U.S. Department of Justice concluded in its 2008 National Drug Assessment, Threat Assessment, that, and I quote, Mexican drug trafficking organizations now represent the greatest organized crime threat to the United States. It's also worth pointing out that the rise of Mexican drug trafficking organizations has been a major threat to democracy in Mexico and has created a wide number of problems south of the border. The reality is that the transnational nature of organized crime means that unilateral policies or policies that simply rely on doing something at the border will not work. Multilateral cooperation is essential. Unfortunately, I think it's fair to say that the governments of the Western Hemisphere have yet to develop adequate multilateral responses. We instead see a welter of different and conflicting policy choices, and drug traffickers have been able to exploit the lack of coordinated governmental response. And that brings us to the subject of today's symposium. And the symposium essentially has three main goals. First is to try to assess the state of organized crime situation in the Western Hemisphere and discuss its underlying causes. Second, the symposium today is looking to analyze the local, national, and regional strategies that have been pursued so far to identify those strategies that are counterproductive as well as those best practices that should be emulated and extended. Third, the purpose of today's symposium is to generate concrete policy ideas for combating organized crime in the Western Hemisphere. and we're going to have three panels. The first panel will look at organized crime and transnational threats in the hemisphere, essentially an effort to explain or review the expansion of organized crime networks in the region. Panel two is entitled Local and National Policy Responses. Here we're going to move to discuss local and national experiences, policy responses, and the lessons learned in Colombia and Mexico. And third panel, Hemispheric and Multilateral Responses, is going to review the national and regional policies of the United States toward organized crime. One last thing is perhaps the most important thing I have here to do today is to A, tell you that this is on the record. People are speaking for the record, and most important thing actually is to say, if you have one of these little devices, a BlackBerry or a cell phone, anything that can go beep in the middle of it, if you could turn it off or put it on mute, we would greatly appreciate it. Once again, I want to thank you very much for coming here today. I'm now going to turn it over to Stanley Arkin to introduce the first panel.
Thank you. This is a very distinguished panel in that all of them have extraordinary experience which touches or thinks about organized crime without actually participating in it. And by the way, there's no emerita today.
Are you sure?
I hope not in your case. I mean, David Holliday, who spent a very big piece of his life working on civil rights or decent living in Central America, and he is now an officer of the Open Society Institute, and in particular in the Latin American focus. Lee Woloski, I've known for years. He's a very fine lawyer. He works for David Boies. He does international cases. We even worked on one or two together. And he worked at the White House working with transnational risks and has a lot to say about organized crime. This is not because he works for a large law firm, but because he has insights go beyond that in a scholarly way. And Will Wechsler is a deputy undersecretary of our Department of Defense. We'll ask some interesting issues as to why we have the Department of Defense doing something we always think in this country the Department of Justice does, or even worldwide. And let me start by saying that organized crime is a very, very abrasive two words. It can mean anything from the people down the street who form a neighborhood gang, Bloods, Crips, can be Hell's Angels, and up to what we ordinarily in this country think of as organized crime. It's always Italian, which, showing the extraordinary quality of this country and its melting pot quality, has changed substantially, so that the Italians are now being very much competed with by the Russians and the Vietnamese and the Hmong, and virtually every other kind of nationality which forms its own organized crime of one kind or another. We're focusing here, as Jim said, on organized crime in this hemisphere because I think largely the enormous narcotics problem and probably people problem, by that I mean immigration and perhaps even people which are forced into particular kinds of occupations which we don't like or think are right. Let me start by asking Lee Woloski, a legal scholar, how you would define this kind of transnational organized crime and give us a bit of your insight as to how it was formed and functioned.
Sure. Let me answer not as a legal scholar, if I may, but as a policy person or a former policy person.
I think that the
primary characteristic of what we're talking about in this forum and what we should be talking about in this forum is whether or not a particular activity impacts national security or impacts the foreign policy objectives of the United States, and therefore rises beyond a law enforcement problem to a problem that requires broader components of the U.S. government, including the Department of Defense, to have a role in resolving it. And that is, in fact, how this issue sort of came about. International organized crime as a national security issue was first identified by President Clinton, who was fond of talking about initially something called the dark side of globalization. And Clinton would go around in the mid-90s in the White House talking to his White House staff about all the bad things that attended the end of the Cold War, all the bad collateral effects that came from the increased mobility.
Organized crime did precede President Clinton.
Absolutely.
Good.
But I think what the point I would leave this group with, and I'll stop here, just to respond to your question, is that I think that organized crime as a national security problem did not precede President Clinton. President Clinton was the first president to stand up in a speech that he gave at the United Nations, actually the 50th anniversary of the United Nations, and he said, international organized crime is a threat to the national security of the United States, and I'm going to do a variety of things, including signing a document called the Presidential Decision Directive, PDD 42, which said as much and instructed his federal bureaucracy, not just law enforcement, but other parts of the federal government, to devise certain responses. Now, it's true and appropriate for this forum that the very first action that was taken under this new presidential directive was a targeted campaign of really warfare against the Cali cartel in Colombia, because the president had identified international narcotics trafficking as being perhaps at that time the prototype of, or the archetype of international organized crime. But there followed from that a number of other groups and organizations that were targeted under that basic step.
But the Cali cartel, you know, renowned as a narcotics cartel, with all kinds of stories coming out about their culture and how they lived together and recruited and the impacts they had on their country, Colombia. But were they an organized crime group just out to make money, breaking some fundamental laws? Or did they also have a political quality to them? Were they allied with the FARC, say, for example, which made it more of a transnational problem?
Well, that's something that I think maybe one of our regional experts can would want to speak to more than I would. But certainly, I think that in Colombia, under that basic framework, we identified both independent and forces that were acting together that impacted the national security of the United States. So not only did we go to war with the drug cartels under this framework, but we proceeded to designate not only the FARC, but the ELN and other groups that were destabilizing Colombia as foreign terrorist organizations. And then, under the same framework, but again, on the implementation, I'll defer to others, we launched Plan Colombia in 2000, which has had a very profound effect in stabilizing Colombia.
Just so we're complete in terms of organized crime in Colombia, South America, or in this hemisphere, narcotics may be the major business, but you would agree that money laundering, which flows from that and obviously has an impact upon our financial systems, and then people movements, immigrants being extracted or placed in other countries, and perhaps even slavery of some kind is also part of their business. That's true as well.
Absolutely. And, many of the groups that we came to target were not only drug trafficking organizations, but were alien smuggling operations, human trafficking organizations, which typically trafficked women into prostitution, arms trafficking organizations, organizations that we were concerned had the ability and willingness to traffic in radiological and radioactive and other types of materials. Not just drugs, but a lot of other bad stuff as well.
Now, is there anything, perhaps I'd ask you, David, which makes this kind of organized crime more a part of the, at least, ostensibly legitimate governments which exist in South America, Central America, and Mexico? Is there a greater intertwining of organized crime in those countries than, say, there is in this country?
Sure. No, that's clearly been the case in Colombia and Mexico, and increasingly in Central America, especially Guatemala, where this year we sort of learned about the parapolitics scandal in Colombia, in which the paramilitaries, which are essentially drug trafficking organizations, have bought off any number of congresspeople and other, including the cousin of the president, who's in jail currently. In Mexico, there's sort of large, there are different estimates about what sort of percentage of the territory is governed, in a sense, alternatively by drug traffickers, from 8% to much higher. But yeah, no, both the economy and the politics are extremely penetrated. In Guatemala, for many years, there's been talk of a parallel government, a parallel power that essentially is the sort of power behind the throne. So electoral politics starts to mean less and less in these kinds of situations. Could I go back and ask Lee, though, what is it about international organized crime that is a national security threat? Is it, for example, with the drug traffickers, is it the introduction of illicit drugs into our country?
We were leaving that for Will. But
oh, okay, that's fine. Well, or whoever. I don't want to. But I'm left with that sort of what's our definition?
That's a great question.
And is there any international organized crime that is not a national security threat?
Do you want to answer that?
Sure. Of course, there's
this is not counting Pancho Villa.
Yes. There is certainly lots of crime and organized crime that goes on all around the world that is not a national security threat. We risk overwhelming our national security apparatus by expanding the definition too large. But I'll give you some examples of some things that clearly are national security threats and are recognized as such and have been increasingly recognized as such over the last two decades of a fairly linear progression across multiple administrations, where we have very clear enemies of the United States, some of which we're fighting right now, that are funded by the proceeds of organized crime. Organized crime is a threat to the national security interests of the United States, where we have criminal organizations who are threatening the basic governance or are threatening the legitimacy of a state that is an ally or of great interest, particular interest to the United States, that is also of clear national security interest to the United States. It is both of those areas where the work of the U.S. government expands beyond the traditional law enforcement agencies and involves the wider national security community, I would argue.
Is there an aspect of our national justice agencies or Department of Justice, we'll leave out our state prosecutorial agencies, but the FBI, Department of Justice, being intrusive in these South American, Central American countries in terms of what we ask of them, in terms of what we expect of them?
Well,
and I'm not talking just about renditions or extraditions.
Well, there are a lot of lessons learned from the relatively powerful and underappreciated successes that we've had in Colombia over the last decade on the security side. And one of those, one of the clear lessons learned is that you need to have clear, strong leadership in the country in question that's willing to cooperate with the United States, that's willing to lead these efforts, that's willing to have the sort of spine of steel that we've seen from Uribe, and then willing to accept the help from our law enforcement organizations on terms that work for them. When we find ourselves in situations where we don't have an adequate partner, then not only do you run into some of these questions that you've just raised, but in the end of the day, the work is not that effective.
But more to the point, we don't allow Mexican or Guatemalan or Brazilian law enforcement officers to roam around this country or to seek to penetrate our organized crime, of which we have some for sure. Mm-hmm. Well, we have our people doing just that, whether they're flying airplanes or they're on the ground.
Everything that we would do in these areas would be with the cooperation of the local government. The local government has to ask us to be there, has to want this kind of assistance. Typically, they've gotten there because they've found that the enemy that they're against has vastly more resources than the state itself, has vastly more capabilities than the state itself. And that's the challenge that they find themselves in. And so then they look for resources. When they choose to combat this threat, they find themselves looking for resources outside their state. And when it works very well, as it has over the last decade in Colombia, it is a methodical, long-term plan of shared responsibility between not only the United States and the countries in question, but the wider international community as well.
But aside from Colombia, wouldn't it be true that every northern South American country and every Central American country, save maybe Honduras today, has some resentment about American law enforcement officers coming in?
Well, I don't know that I'd be so sweeping, but what I would say, and I defer a lot.
I left out Colombia.
I defer a lot of this to my colleagues in the Justice Department to work more directly. But what I would say is that where this works is where we are working in concert with the government in question. In some places in this hemisphere, we're working in great concert. It's not just in Colombia, but in others, we're not at all. And when we're not, when you don't have that leadership, you end up finding the countries in a very challenging situation.
Dave, could you talk about why in the last 20 years, I think some people said 10, 20, but 20 years where we've recognized this as a serious problem and not before?
Well, to the extent that we're talking about drug trafficking, I do think there's... I wouldn't entirely root it in this, but the 1988 UN Convention on Drugs, which sort of set a framework in which, by definition, any possession of illicit drugs is should be criminalized. And I think that we've seen a lot of changes over the last 20 years. I'm going to speak in very broad strokes here, so I hope I don't simplify it. But when I look at the kinds of policies that have emanated from a sort of both a military and a criminal prosecution of this situation, I think you can see a lot of that we've often contributed to the problem more than we've helped. In the U.S., the sort of the prison population has grown enormously due to the incarceration of often nonviolent drug offenders. Prisons, both in the U.S. and in Latin America, have become factories for organized crime.
We know that the U.S. has more people per capita in jail than any country in the world.
That's right. And we often see, I would be interested to know, for example, we know that we don't know a lot about our counter-narcotic sort of treaties and agreements. They're often secret agreements, but we do know. I know that 10 years ago, Ecuador, we conditioned our counter-narcotics assistance on an increase in arrests. Again, you know, just blossoming their prison population and the current government, which is not considered an ally, but, you know, is taking perhaps a different approach to how to deal with this kind of problem. So that's one thing. The other issue is I think that Colombia has become, because of there was this ideological component, obviously a civil war in Colombia, and it became tied up with the drug war, that sort of came onto our radar. Now, there are scholars who argue that a lot of, again, our policies of trying to attack the FARC in particular, and the ELN in Colombia, the guerrilla organizations, was counterproductive. Eradication policies, which sort of pushed the local population into the hands of the guerrillas and increased their political capital, because we were not prepared to offer alternative livelihoods, and frankly, the problem is with a lot of these strategies, which we're sort of now importing to Mexico, is that the sort of direct confrontation with the drug cartels has not necessarily reduced the flow of drugs. And so it's hard for me to look at Colombia and say that there's a success there, because organized crime, one of the key, when you're a clandestine or sort of underground organization, is much easier to adapt, and the governments and the other forces are much slower to adapt. And we've seen sort of the emergence of smaller cartels So it's not just the FARC that's doing drug trafficking, but also these other cartels from former paramilitaries. So I don't see that has been successful at all in Mexico. In the case of Mexico, one can argue, as some have done, von der Felbe Brown from the Brookings Institution has written about this, that sort of pushing to sort of confront the cartels increased the violence, and it's still sort of, the jury's still out as to whether that's going to somehow reduce violence in the long run, reduce the political power of the cartels. Certainly, I think the sort of level of influence of cartels, both in Colombia and Mexico, is still pretty immense.
Is there any justice system south of the border? Certainly Canada has a justice system, but it's quite small compared to ours. Is there any justice system south of the border, including Central America, Mexico, South America, which you can speak of respectfully?
Actually, the Colombian justice system isn't bad.
Except for Colombia.
And Chilean. Chile, I would say.
Chile?
Chile.
You've been in a Chilean jail?
No.
You've been in a Mexican jail?
I haven't been in either, no. But in terms of sort of respect for the rule of law and sort of independence of the judiciary, I think there are probably I would say Chile over. But Colombia, I mean, surprisingly, is not bad. And that's, again, another interesting thing. It's not to the degree that there's been any sort of prosecution of organized crime, I think you can attribute it more to police work and the judicial authorities and not to sort of military interventions. Military approaches tend to just spread the problem around. The reason drugs are coming out of Venezuela now is because we've had some success in controlling the borders or the distribution from Colombia. So it all goes now through Venezuela. Mexico is spilling over into Guatemala. So there's no, these kinds, we don't have a sort of an overall vision of how to sort of approach this problem.
Let me, if I may, sure. Let me answer the question that you asked before, which was, how does it really affect the national security of the United States? I think I'll answer in the non-Western Hemisphere context, if that's okay, just because, first, I'm not an expert in the Western Hemisphere, and secondly, because I recognize that there's a lot of debate around counter-narcotics policy specifically. But I'll give you two examples that I think sort of crystallize it from the standpoint of the place that both Will and I sat in the Clinton administration and me for the first part of the Bush administration. We discovered that there was a, we asked ourselves the question, how is a Taliban in Afghanistan when it was in place supplying itself? How are they getting stuff in contravention of a variety of sanctions regimes? We found that there was an illicit aviation network that had over 100 planes operating out of the former former Russian military official who had commandeered scores of planes, big planes, cargo planes, that he was using out of bases all over the world. He was registering them in some jurisdictions. He was keeping them in other jurisdictions. He employed dozens of people, hundreds of people, in furtherance of this illicit project. Now, what he was bringing into the Taliban, or into Afghanistan for the Taliban and perhaps for others, on those planes, we presumed to be weapons. We presumed to be money. We presumed to be other material support that was necessary for the regime's survival. That became a problem that was sort of separate and distinct from the issue of how do we deal with al-Qaeda, how do we deal with the Taliban, and became how do we deal with this aviation network. That was a national security problem because we had a very clear interest in shutting off the Taliban's ability to survive. Another problem, when we were pursuing in the earlier phases of NATO expansion, We found that many of the countries that were candidates for NATO membership were ones that had problems with international organized crime. And not only did they have problems with international organized crime, specifically emanating from the former Soviet Union, but those organized crime bodies were embedded in the governance structure of the countries that were being proposed for NATO membership. So the question became, how do we assure the integrity of the command and control mechanism of NATO if and when NATO is expanded into some of these countries? So these are clearly, I would say, problems that transcend, you know, law enforcement, and they become problems that impact the foreign policy interests and national security interests of the United States writ large, and they therefore require sort of all the folks, you know, from Will's part of the government, all the folks from other parts of the government to figure out how to address them. And in cases where we believe that we can actually take down some of these organizations, to actually put in place mechanisms to take them down.
Lee has touched upon next subject, which I think we should go to, which is what are the commonalities, which is one question, and then the connections, the other question, between these cartels. We're not talking about street organized crime, these international cartels, Mexican and others, to what we now dub terrorist groups. Will?
Well, in
certainly the Taliban would be.
Yeah, I mean, in some cases they're one and the same. The FARC was designated as a terrorist organization and as a narcotics trafficking organization. Narcotics and other organized crime support many terrorist organizations. I'm hard pressed to think of a terrorist organization that does not use organized crime as a way to help fund and manage its logistics in one way or the other. Some are much more expert and have been doing this for a long time, for organizations like Hezbollah. When an organization establishes the infrastructure for trafficking, for moving things illicitly, those who desire to move things illicitly will make use of that infrastructure. And we see that all around the world.
Yeah, but are any of these organizations we call international criminal cartels, international crime, are they a major bankrolling or other support facility things like Al-Qaeda?
Well, most criminal organizations are out to make money, first and foremost. There are some that have they're ideologically based organizations or territorial based organizations that have other aspirations as well and use organized crime to further those. And there can be a wonderful debate about are they first and foremost a criminal organization, or are they first and foremost an ideological organization or a terrorist organization? But I think what's a powerful point to understand is even if the criminal organizations have no ideological objectives, even if they have no wider objectives beyond making money, once they establish the infrastructure necessary to move things illicitly, what we tend to see is that infrastructure is taken advantage of by other organizations that want to employ it for their own ends. Doesn't mean that they do it a tremendous amount. Different organizations do it at different degrees, but we definitely see that.
Is that by force or agreement?
It's by mutual benefit. If the criminal organization is looking to make money and someone provides them a way to do that, they will quite often take them up on it.
And what's different, though, in Afghanistan than it is in Mexico?
Yeah, it's very different.
And that difference is?
But just a question to you, Will. I know there's a concern about about the sort of pipeline being used by either criminals or terrorists, but are there any cases yet of Al-Qaeda using the drug cartels or the human smuggling networks from Mexico into the U.S. Do we know?
From Mexico and the United States? The question before was a global phenomenon.
No, I understand.
But Mexico to the United States, no, we don't have that. I mean, there's a lot of overstatements that's been made in the last year about this dynamic of the threat from Mexico. The problems in Mexico are quite serious, are big challenges, and the president there is taking many very powerful steps against them, and the progress that's been made and the changes in the even U.S.-Mexican dynamic on this issue have been quite powerful in a relatively short period of time. That all said, Mexico is not a failed state. It's not going to be a failed state. There's not this massive spillover of violence right across the border. I mean, you go to Ciudad Juarez, which is one of the most dangerous places in the world, and right across the border is El Paso, which I think is the third most safe city in America, of its size. All these things, which are very much hyped in the press, we don't see. There is wider implications.
You don't see Laredo?
There are some. The wider implication that I was going to say is not the spillover like directly across the border, although there are some places where we, but the wider spillover of Mexican criminal organizations very far from the border that are very powerful role to play in the criminality in the United States. That's what's been building up over longer periods of time. I mean, there are places in, you know, the park system in California where industrial size marijuana production is being done by the Mexican drug cartels. I mean, it's that kind of spillover that's much more significant than the kind that gets more of the press of in a border town there being violence.
So it seems that while terrorist organizations may be able to take advantage of organized crime networks, do they really need? Except for getting certain kinds of goods, to pose a direct national security threat to the U.S., do they need organized crime? I mean, the U.S. is so porous; its borders are so porous; it's so easy to sort of get into the U.S. And in fact, one of the characteristics of organized crime is this sort of blurring of the lines between legal and illegal. There's a lot of legal enterprises that are used by organized crime. So, it's
The mechanisms, the skills, the models, and then even the actual logistics are used by terrorist organizations all around the world. I mean, if you want to, and we see it again and again and again.
In combination with criminal cartels.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that does happen. There is a robust, network of groups that operate transnationally that seem to know how to find each other. So with such effectiveness that sometimes when we were in government, we would wonder why we couldn't find them as quickly as they found each other. But it is true that if you are, a bad guy, whether you're a terrorist organization or another bad guy, and you need some specific thing, whether it's money moved, arms moved, you need a plane, you need something else, you need, bad things moved. There are people that you can call, and they'll do it, and they do it for money. I mean, you may have, Will pointed to the distinction between terrorist groups, which typically, at least in the scholarship, we say that they have ideological objectives. International organized crime groups have purely monetary ones, but they do know how to find each other. There's ample example of them finding each other, I think we spoke to some of the specific examples,
One of the strategic improvements in our thinking as a government over the last 10 to 15 years has been a moving away from a siloed approach to thinking about these issues, that there are these kinds of criminals and these kinds of terrorists and these kinds of organizations. The reality is that there's a nexus between all of them, and when the nexus impacts our national security, we have to change the way that we think about national security. So in Afghanistan, at the end of last year, there was a change in the rules of engagement for the drug trafficking organizations with ties to the insurgency to be a formal target of our military actions. In the previous ways of thinking, you would say there's insurgency and there's narco trafficking. What we've learned is that A doesn't meet the facts, and B hinders our ability to actually.
Is there any evidence of the very powerful, well-organized Mexican and South American cartels, say the Sinaloa cartel, being active or forming relationships in Europe or in East Asia or in Southeast Asia?
Very, very much so. One of the dynamics that we see more recently is the narcotics that are coming out of South America, a lot of which are coming out of Venezuela, and I would say that it's not just because of our success in
no.
Colombia, but there are some Venezuela specific issues that drive that.
Sure.
Going not only to the U.S. market but going to the European market, and when they look as businessmen to the European market, they see that that prices are higher. They see that demand has a way to go up for cocaine, whereas it's relatively saturated and flat in the United States. And they see that the potential downside for action that is perhaps remote but quite catastrophic in the United States of being being put in our jails and actually being caught is an extremely low probability in Europe. They just don't have the enforcement track record that we do. So over the next decade, one would expect an increasing proportion of the cocaine trade to be going to Europe and to the Middle East, where it's even more profitable to do so. And one of the great challenges is that there are countries in the way in Western Africa that are already starting to and about to be swamped by this program. The amount of resources that the cartels can throw at these countries will dwarf the amount of resources that these countries can on their own use to defend against this.
Well, just a particular issue, which is that are the Mexican cartels with their extraordinary distribution systems helping the Afghanis distribute their opium harvest?
I haven't seen anything along those lines, no. I mean, the vast majority of the opium harvest in Afghanistan goes to Europe, not to the United States.
And therefore the Mexicans wouldn't be necessarily involved with it.
Yeah, I haven't, of all the problems that we have, that one I put weight.
No, I guess my question was further, which is, is this country the prime or almost sole customer of the Sinaloa cartel and other cartels based in Mexico and the northern South American cartels?
We consume 90% of all the cocaine that's coming up there or more. I mean, we as President Obama said when we went down to Mexico, is that this is a co-responsibility for this. We have a co-responsibility for this problem. And as you said earlier, there was a day when the Mexicans were just a transit state. And this is a common dynamic that we see all around the world, is that in a variety of countries, they choose not to address this issue because they see themselves as being just a transit state. I don't know of any country in the world that has ever remained just a transit state. They eventually become massive users. They become kind of massive organized crime. Countries make mistakes when they don't address this problem at an earlier stage, and they wait till it becomes a massive internal.
Have they become too powerful, Dave, to put down in Mexico? I know that you said there's not a failed government in Mexico. There's not. You said it three times, mm-hmm. Not a failed government. So let's accept that as rhythm. But is there the power in that government to put down these cartels?
I wish I had the solution here.
I'm going to ask you in a while for one.
It's easy to sort of critique the current strategy, although we do have to see how it plays. I mean, I'm somewhat sympathetic to the use of deploying the military in a country where the police are incredibly corrupt and have very little capacity for dealing with the cartels. The question is, what are you really trying to achieve? Because let's assume the best scenario, that we are able to dismantle these cartels. Is that really a possibility? And if it's not, and is it as a possibility as long as consumption remains the way it does in the U.S. and Europe of marijuana, cocaine, whatever? If it's not a possibility, then what should our goals be? Now, the goal of Calderon is to sort of break up the cartels into small cartels. Okay, we've done that in Colombia. Cocaine continues to flow. Influence in politics continues. So is that a good strategy? Is that going to actually kind of resolve the problem? It may lower the incidence of violence, but it's not a very happy, scenario.
Well, you've led into my last set. Excuse me, well, go ahead.
I just say, if the measure of success here is critically important, if your measure of success is that there's no crime, then there's no country in the history of the world that will ever meet that measure of success. The measure of success, I would argue, is first and foremost that this criminal activity does not pose a national security threat to the United States or the country. That's the problem in Mexico, is that it has risen to the point where there are ungoverned spaces. In Colombia, I think I have to make sure that I leave the audience with an alternative viewpoint than the one that you suggested earlier. I was out of government from the end of the Clinton administration to the beginning of the Obama administration. When I left, over two-thirds of the Colombian people believed that the FARC, that it was going to take Bogota and was going to take over the whole government. When you look at it at the time, if you look at the areas that the Bogota government actually controlled, you are not too far out of Bogota. The situation today is a night and day difference. When I come back into government, it is amazing how much has been changed. Everything that you criticized is absolutely true as well. There is still a tremendous flow of narcotics going up. This is not, this is not the kind of conflict where a statue comes down and everyone recognizes that as the victory point. This is a long, methodical process that has already taken over a decade since Plan Colombia, and is going to take another decade to deal with the wider problems. There are human rights problems. There are continuing problems that go on. But the security situation, is a night and day difference, down to the point that you made about the justice situation. You would never have said that about the Colombian justice system at the end of the last decade, what you said about the Colombian justice system at the end of this decade. And about what comes in, you said about, going for other alternatives and building up what they call the CCAI, is designed to do exactly that, and has been. And this is a Colombian effort, not ours, that started about 4 or 5 years ago, that has had real demonstrable progress in building up the areas that have been taken in, what we at the Pentagon would see as a classic counterinsurgency strategy, to hold and then to build. So there are no shortage of challenges for the Colombian government. The Colombian government would be the very first to talk about them, but I think we do ourselves a disservice if we don't realize how incredibly far they've come. Not only to give them credit, but as part of the lessons learned for what we might think about in other contexts and in other places. There is a road, there is a path to go down. We're not in the end zone yet, but we've come a huge degree.
I'm going to ask each of you, before I open it up to our guests, what would you do if you had your will to change our policies or our actions to diminish the threat to our country? And I am assuming right now, that question assumes, that these cartels are at the very height of their power. Mm-hmm. They have not become more limpid as time has gone on. They have become more dangerous. In fact, they don't even have free speech any longer in northern Mexico.
Well, if I could wave a magic wand, of course, you'd get rid of the demand problem in the United States.
All you have
States.
To do is speak. No magic wands.
that's of course, a critical element of all of everything that we do. The other things that I would suggest, and is some of, amongst the lessons that we've learned in the Colombian context, is that it requires the government in question to have the critically strong and consistent leadership of a kind that is very rare all around the world. When we have it, we need to take advantage of it. Secondly, we need a whole of government from the United States approach to these issues. The Department of Defense is not in any way, shape, or form the lead agency on this. We are a supporting agency. We have some capabilities and skills that are appropriate for these jobs, but other agencies have the authorities, have the skills that are vastly more important for these jobs. And so we need a whole of government approach to this. And then the one thing that we haven't done a good job...
Do we have that?
We have had that in Colombia. That's part of the success story.
Aside from Colombia, do we have, which you just said, the whole government?
We have not applied all the lessons of Colombia elsewhere yet. And the other thing that I would say that we didn't really do even well in Colombia is a wider regional approach, because you end up getting the balloon effect where you're squeezing it in one place and then the drugs go someplace else. I don't think that was, my recollection from the 90s, there's actually a judgment that the region perhaps wasn't ready for that kind of regional approach. It might be ready for that kind of regional approach now, and it's certainly necessary if we're going to address it more successfully.
Well, Lee, if you were the anti-cartel czar, I'd like to pay czar, what would you do?
Well, we may need such a czar, because I want to underscore the point that Will made about viewing this problem from a government-wide basis. I mean, in many ways, our government is still set up to fight states. And increasingly, you know, as we know from 9/11, the challenges that we face emanate from non-state actors. And much of the progress that's been made in the past 8 years has really been in response to the specific terrorism threat, Al-Qaeda in particular. But it has not yet addressed these other very important challenges from non-state actors that are not strictly terrorist organizations. And so, you know, I'm mostly being facetious about the need for another czar, but the point is that, you know, Will's point is very important. We need to devise better a better approach that incorporates the, you know, different parts of our government to address these problems. Additionally, we need stronger governance, because the reason why we have these problems frequently is because of weak governance in certain states that do not have the ability to fight these organizations that take root on their soil.
Dave?
Yeah, I don't disagree with anything that's been said.
But
I will say more. Well, first of all, I agree with the regional approach. The problem is that, actually, let me start back. I think there's some good things that the Obama administration has done that is different. There has been an effort to coordinate creating this International Organized Crime Task Force or something. Mm-hmm. The Defense Department is not a member of that. Every other agency in Washington is. So I'm not, even though it's an international organized crime, so I'd be curious to understand why that is. But that's there's clearly sort of been a turf battles and turf wars that have gone on that have inhibited the fight against organized crime. The drug czar that has traditionally also tackled international issues has importantly kind of discarded the notion of a war on drugs, because it's a war that you can't win, I would suspect is one of the reasons, and really started to focus more on prevention and treatment, you know, death-related drug issues, and kind of breaking the ties between drugs and crime. And I think that's a very positive thing. I think on the international level, we haven't kind of come up with a new approach. And so to go to what we should do, I think the regional approach is important. Unfortunately, that regional approach is happening, and the U.S. isn't part of it. The base agreement that the U.S. just signed with Colombia really irked a lot of the South American countries in particular. And when, it's not just Chavez; it's Brazil and Chile and Argentina, and they're all looking to some kind of cooperation that does not include the U.S. So the U.S. has a lot to offer, and they have a big task in front of them if they're going to sort of engage with the rest of Latin America. I also think that just as we're focusing on demand reduction and essentially decriminalization, as we sort of as we leave it to the states to look at medical marijuana laws or decide to move our resources not towards breaking up medical marijuana dispensaries and leaving sort of different initiatives coming out of states to decriminalize, I think we need to allow that to go forward in Latin America as it is going forward, because we'll mention the sort of we are the principal producers of marijuana. As it turns out, that the Mexican drug trafficking organizations are controlling part of that market. The DEA says that 65% of the Mexican drug cartels' profits come from marijuana, not from cocaine. So, what happens to the business model of the cartels if we decriminalize, if we legalize? Now, we can't do that, as Francisco Toomey pointed out, until we change the international convention. So that's another struggle. But I think we have to look at a different paradigm for approaching this issue. That's not, and I totally agree in terms of improving governance and police and judicial apparatuses. One other thing I would just say there, the U.S. seems to be exporting a lot of the RICO-like kind of statutes in terms of wiretapping and you know, special courts or asset forfeiture, that sort of thing. Again, Colombia, a lot of the wiretapping, when you export these sort of tools to countries in which there's not great accountability, you run into problems. And we have the case of Colombia this year where the intelligence services was found to be, you know, spending a lot of time spying on human rights organizations, on opposition politicians, including, you know, there's wiretaped phone calls with U.S. Embassy personnel. So I think, you know, those, now that kind of thing comes out because of the press, you know, often, and not because of horizontal accountability institutions like the courts. So I think that's something we need to be concerned about. I think a lot of the RICO kinds of procedures are useful, but we need to be careful.
Well, it leads me just to the last question I'm going to ask before I open it up, which you talk about the press. There is no free press in northern Mexico. You agree with that? That is to say...
Well, they're intimidated, yeah.
It's edited by bullets.
Yeah. There's a lot of self-censorship.
Right. And we have, just below us in northern Mexico, we have lawlessness, thousands of killings. Is that a law enforcement problem, a governance problem? And what can we directly do about that, aside from doing what we did earlier in the last century? Who rode across the border and captured Pancho Villa? But we can't do that now. There's UN. What can you do about these major cartels?
You asking me?
Send drones? No.
No. What we can do is while understanding all of the tremendous differences between our experience in Colombia and the experience in Mexico and other places, but we can nevertheless look at the lessons that we've learned in this great success. Everything that's being written now about Mexico, I recall reading almost word for word the same articles about Colombia a decade ago. Those articles aren't being written about Colombia because of the successes that we've had. The people forget that we didn't have President Uribe when Plan Colombia was started. We do have the advantage of having President Calderon in Mexico, who has been very steadfast and very clear in his leadership on this issue. So we have a wonderful opportunity, and now as the last administration started taking advantage of it with the Merida initiative, and the question will be what comes after for the longer term work that needs to be done, because this is a long term issue. This issue is not solved in a matter of months or years, but in a matter of decades.
I don't know if we solve what we do with these people in northern Mexico, but I'm sure some of the questions from you will help. If you stand, identify yourself, speak clearly and succinctly. The gentleman back there.
Hello. My name is Jorge Mariscal. I work for the Royalton Group. Organized crime in the U.S., you know, clearly, if what you're saying about the consumption of narcotics in the U.S. is as large as you point, how is it possible that it gets distributed so widely within the U.S.? What are the networks that operate with, you know, a lot of impunity to carry out these tasks? And related to that, is there also a similar network that distributes guns the other way? And what are the, you know, is it so well organized in the U.S. that we don't even call it organized crime, that we don't see it? Or can you maybe touch on this point?
Lee, I think you should take it. It's a legal question.
Okay. Again, I'll dodge your question a little bit by saying that when we were in the government, when I was in the government, and I think I can speak for Will too, although he's capable of speaking for himself quite well, our function was really to stop at the water's edge. In other words, to look out from the water's edge. We didn't involve ourselves. I didn't involve myself as a government official in, you know, domestic law enforcement contexts. So I have not a great deal of visibility on the local networks that are the, you know, in many cases the end of a global network. You know, I will say though that just as my, you know, from my experience as a practicing lawyer, certainly the distribution mechanisms in this country for drugs and for guns are very diverse. I mean, you have very well-organized networks that are purely domestic in character engaged in those activities. You have very fragmented and atomistic participants engaged in those activities with really little connection to others, either in this country or abroad. And you have groups in this country that are working very tightly with component parts that are operating outside of the United States.
Dave? Just, Cameron, I think the distribution systems in this country may depend to some extent upon the Mexican cartels. You see evidence of that. We have a huge Mexican population, not just in the Southwest, but all through our Midwest. And certainly some of those people are engaged in helping in distribution, though I don't know that that's a major problem, which really is what exists just below the water, the Rio Grande. Now questions. Rita.
Rita Hauser, well, you particularly laud the success in Colombia, but you kind of glossed over the paramilitaries, the abuses that took place in human rights, which are now we're seeing in Mexico as well, Uribe's attempts to perpetuate his rule, which has just been thwarted, but maybe will succeed. So it's a more mixed picture than I think you have presented. And I would like to ask at the same time, of David, how you see these kinds of things in Mexico. There's an article in the current Atlantic just out, which I happened to read last evening, which describes a horrendous situation in northern Mexico, particularly the complete corruption of the military. And the author concludes that several states, in effect, there's been what he calls a coup, that those states are no longer really under the effective control of Calderon. And he asks the question whether or not Calderon's war on drugs, which has taken some 14,000 lives and instituted a kind of mini civil war, was the right approach and worth the price?
That's a wonderful question. We'll have Rita suggesting in a way, she didn't use the words, but northern Mexico may be like a failed state.
Well,
she didn't say it, though.
Let me first on Colombia. I'm sorry to leave the impression that there were no problems in Colombia. I tried to make the point, that I'll make again, that civil rights, human rights issues have been a massive problem, will continue to be a significant problem for Colombia. That's the kind of problem that you don't solve. It's a continuing process. Things have improved, but there are still concerns, and those concerns have been made clear by everyone in our government, and also are recognized by the Colombian government. The other areas that need to continue challenge the Colombian government are the movement of the drug, are the continuing of the drug trafficking. Again, the overall volume of cocaine has not decreased the way that we would have wanted it to, and the movement from the FARC to the Bakrims and the other criminal organizations, including some with paramilitary ties, that we need to get on top of those as well. I don't want to leave the impression that we are declaring success and that we're dancing in the end zone with Colombia. We still have a way to go, but I do want to recognize how, to continue the sports metaphor, about how far we have come down the field. I think to fail to do that would be to miss a very powerful story that I believe is generally underappreciated, and one that also has lessons for the wider discussion we're having in Mexico and in other places around the world.
Is Calderon becoming a Uribe in that regards? The Rita was asking you, can the Mexican government cope with these huge cartels, heavily armed, who have corrupted the army, killed the police? What can they do to get back northern Mexico?
I think what Calderon says is that we've seen the results of not taking action, which is this problem getting bigger and bigger and bigger. A number of the steps that the Calderon administration has taken have been very, very well received by the population and by the United States, and we look forward to ways to be helpful as they desire. But as I said before, this only works when the countries in question want the United States help. We can't force it on them. And speaking for the Department of Defense, we are again, a supporting role, and there are other parts of the U.S. government that will provide the leadership for the work that we will be doing at the Mexican government's request. I personally thought that Atlantic article was very, very much overstated for my taste.
Do you want to add to that, Dave?
Yeah, well, just the comparison between the paramilitaries in Colombia and the drug cartels in Mexico, and Shannon or Andrew have probably better data on this, but my understanding from the Mexico Institute report earlier this year is that most of the violence is not civilian, sort of bystanders. Now, in Colombia, the paramilitaries early on functioned as a proxy army against the FARC, and there were massacres. So that's a very different situation. Mm-hmm. You don't have that ideological component here, and much of the violence is coming either between rival cartels or between the state, police and military. And there are obviously lots of civilian casualties, but it's not quite the same. Mm-hmm. In terms of, I still don't. I wish maybe at the end of the day we'll have an answer to how to resolve the problems in northern Mexico. But it is true that whatever we do, unless we have a different approach, we're just going to push it somewhere else. I spoke with the former prime minister of Haiti the other day, and she was saying, concerned about the drug trafficking issue there, and I said, well, actually, most of it's now going over Central America, but Secretary Clinton admitted to her, yes, to the extent that we have success in Mexico, just going to go elsewhere. So, I mean, we can't, we have to look realistically at a situation where we can't sort of engage every single government in the hemisphere and sort of deploy forces, and that's just not going to work. It's going to get pushed somewhere.
But it could be pushed a long way away. Lady on the edge, I don't know your name, I'm
Meg.
Sorry.
Meg Crahan, Columbia University. In November of 2008, the Attorney General of the state of Texas issued a report stating that approximately 20% of the human trafficking by cartels passed through or occurred in Texas, and he called upon the state legislature to adopt regulations in order to make the local authorities as well as the state authorities more empowered to deal with this problem. There's similar weakness both in Texas and California in terms of state banking regulation and elsewhere in terms of arms sales in the United States. Absent state regulation to empower local and state authorities, what can the federal government do to deal with the presence of criminal cartels in a number of areas within states and municipalities?
So we go to the lawyer first.
That's a very, very, very...
I surrender my credential to you, Lee.
It's a very good question. Of course, the federal government has prerogatives in both, border control, human movement issues domestically, and also in with respect to the financial system. But you have identified, a very important issue, at least in terms of the financial system, which is where I've spent most of my time looking and working in the past decade or so, because to the extent that local law enforcement and local regulators have primary frontline responsibility for enforcement, in many respects they are, as is implicit in your question, woefully under funded, they don't have the skills to deal with problems that are truly international in scope. They don't know what they're looking for in many cases, and they don't know how to address it. There's been a lot of work in this area in the past few years. A lot of the money, I believe, needs to come, from the federal government. A lot of the training appropriately comes from the federal government, whether it's in joint task forces or in other mechanisms. But it's a very important issue. Ironically, there's sort of a flip side to it, which is, local governments that want to play in the international arena put in place rules that prohibit their public pension funds from making investments in certain. They try to conduct a, certain jurisdictions have tried to conduct an independent foreign policy through regulation by indicating what state entities and state instrumentalities can and cannot say invest in. Different problem, but a part of the same coin in the sense that we do have local law enforcement, local regulators on the financial side, which still are under-resourced and frankly just do not yet have the tools to deal with problems that are international in scope.
I think also she may have been asking whether it would be feasible in this country to either close down or sternly regulate, severely regulate the sale of guns, particularly in our southern states or border states.
Good luck on that, I think.
What's that? Good luck.
Good luck on that.
The Second Amendment, I know.
Second Amendment poses a bit of a problem.
Too many turkeys to shoot.
Yeah.
Gentleman over here.
Hi, my name is Samuel Logan. I'm with Southern Pulse. I'd like to continue on the human smuggling angle a bit. When we talk about organized crime, a lot of the focus happens to be on drugs and guns these days. My understanding is that in Mexico, when you talk about movement of product, illicit product from south to north, humans are second only to the drugs. So I couple that with the understanding that in countries like Honduras, up to July or June of this year, and Ecuador and Colombia for a time, they were very relaxed with visa restrictions, allowing all sorts of people to come into their country with an easy stamp, 3 months, and on you go. So my question is, in terms of considering the policy that we're pushing beyond the edge of the water, should we, when we talk about the Merida Initiative or some sort of continuation of Plan Colombia, should there be a strong component towards human smuggling? And should that component be or not be bundled or coupled with considerations for immigration and deportation policy?
Does anybody volunteer? Good.
Yes, I think it should be coupled with immigration reform specifically, and I was heartened to see that the Obama administration has not given up on that before seeking, and they're going to push something forward. I mean, I think the visa issue is one thing, but it's very clear that, it feels clear to me, that sort of efforts to seal the border, improve kind of transit in El Paso and California, sort of pushed things into Arizona. And all the reports, journalistic reports coming out of Mexico, indicate that you can't cross the border anymore unless you pay the narcos. So this is what we've done. This is what our policy has done. We've sort of, you drive things underground and you empower criminal organizations. If we have a more open, rational policy, which I think this administration would like to push for. In fact, President Bush was fairly rational on this as well. Just couldn't get it through Congress. Then I think we have a chance of reversing that situation.
Do you think the narcos control immigration, that is to say, illegal immigration into this country from southern?
There's quite a few reports indicating that. If you go and hang out in these sort of border towns along Arizona, you can't get into the desert unless in the old days you might have paid the cops, and now you have to pay the narcos who have the cops under their control.
I have the gentleman. Yes, sir. Then I'll get to you.
See, I'm Francisco Tumi. I'm from the University of Texas and a Colombian American. Will, I hope you're right. I don't think you are.
Who are you looking at when you say that?
Will.
Well, so it's during the Uribe administration, there were only 1.5 million displaced persons. National Democratic Security, I want to know who benefits from democratic security. Obviously, they don't. Álvaro Uribe has deinstitutionalized a lot of the state, his concentrated power. You praise the justice system. There is a continuous clash between Álvaro Uribe and the justice system in Colombia. As I say, I hope you're right. I don't think the situation is sustainable. There has been economic growth with no employment, and the concentration of wealth has increased dramatically, especially in the countryside. So the question is, where is the success? We might have short-term success, I hope there will be in the future. I thoroughly disagree with you on that. I don't think there is.
What's Uribe's latest approval rating inside Colombia?
Uh, 64%. Álvaro Uribe is the best president for Colombia. Mm-hmm. Because Álvaro Uribe is paternalistic, authoritarian, messianic, and he also interprets the law in a way that he breaks the law, or at least the spirit of the law, without breaking the law. The problem is not Álvaro Uribe. The problem is Colombian society. And if we do not make reforms that are serious in Colombia, the country will go to pot with Álvaro Uribe as president.
Well, just can you respond to that?
Well, we obviously have a different point of view. I only look at where Colombia was, where it is today, and where the population of Colombia itself feels about the situation. I would also note, this is a little off topic, but one thing that I didn't mention before is that Colombia is now in a position where it can help other countries. It's an amazing thing to think about from the end of the last decade to this decade, that they have made public offers to help in Afghanistan, made public offers to help in training in variety regionally in the Western Hemisphere.
But not in Venezuela.
Not in Venezuela.
I have a question. I think you had your hand up first. I'll try to get everybody. We have about 10 minutes.
Lucy Commissar, I'm a journalist. The question is for Lee. I was interested in what you said about the Taliban had an illicit aviation network run by a former Russian military official and with bases around the world. Was that Victor Boot?
Yes.
Okay. So I understand that the U.S. used the Victor Boot system. It was either to ferry materials to Afghanistan or Iraq. Isn't that true?
I read those reports.
So what does this say about the, does one hand not know what the other is doing? What does this say about what the U.S., how serious it is in dealing with what was a huge threat? I mean, the Taliban now is perhaps our largest single security threat. And are there some other examples from Latin America that perhaps David could mention where we're doing the similar, what seems to me, actions that don't make a lot of sense?
Thank you. David?
I have to think about that.
I'm glad the question was addressed to you.
But I mean, I compare, is there a Victor Bout kind of scenario in Latin America? And I have to think about that.
We'll pass for a moment while you're thinking. Gentlemen,
is there an answer to the first part?
Well, it was that I read those reports. I mean, that happened. I don't know how that happened. That happened after I left the government. I think I'm on record saying that it boggles the mind how folks who were running the Iraq war could have used as a subcontractor, as I understand it, on Pentagon contracts to deliver materials into Baghdad, someone who was years before running arms to the Taliban.
We have yet to have anybody, though, on our payroll distributing narcotics in this country. That's true, isn't it? No, now, excuse me, Lucy. We have to have other people to ask. Gentlemen behind.
Just one thing. Victor Bout is in jail right now in Thailand. For those who don't know the end of this story, and it remains to be seen whether or not they will extradite. That is.
You're talking about a prisoner in Mexico being extradited here?
No, in Thailand.
Victor Bout is in jail.
Victor Boot.
Victor Bout is in Thailand. Is in a Thai jail right now.
Right. Excellent.
And we're awaiting extradition, and it remains to be seen whether it will happen. And the Colombians sent a team over to Thailand to explain. Because it is actually involved, the case involves the FARC, mm-hmm. to explain that the FARC is a terrorist organization and to help the case against Victor Bout. This is why, as this is one of many, many examples about, again, as I was saying, about these old pipe, these old stovepipes of issues. They all come together, these nexus. So all three stories that we've been talking about come together right now in Thailand.
You meant silos?
Silos, yeah. Sorry.
But your question is what, really?
Christopher Johnson, the RAND Corporation. I just wanted to see if you guys could comment quickly. We've been talking a bit about strategies sort of on the military side, but I was wondering if you guys could comment on any sort of strategies the U.S. has sort of put in place to deal with sort of some of the micro problems of sort of recruitment and retention of the sort of young male population in Latin America that has been heavily involved in.
David.
Well, I would say we have an active policy of deporting criminals, some of whom have grown up in the U.S., not helping out with their reinsertion into Central American societies. Pretty mum about sort of incarceration policies of such of these. In fact, we build prisons in El Salvador where gangs are essentially in control of the entire prison. So. I don't think we have very good strategies at the moment. It feels like you're talking sort of at a street gang level or the Mara Salvatrucha and that sort of thing. Sam Logan can talk a lot about that too. But I think there's, as part of the Merit Initiative, there is a component there of supporting crime prevention in especially in Central America. But it's quite small in comparison to probably what is needed.
I'm sorry, you were. I'm trying to keep mental order of who put up their
hands.
Good
morning, Brian O'Neill. I wanted to ask you a question in this context of organized crime and threats, and bearing in mind what Will's reminded us of a couple times of not dealing with these issues in silos, whether it's criminal or terrorist or national security interests. What do we know about state-sponsored activities of Venezuela, whether activities or funding, ALDO countries or other countries, but destabilizing democratic institutions or perpetuating or funding or encouraging undemocratic behaviors. Honduras comes to mind, Nicaragua comes to mind, Ecuador, Bolivia. Looking forward, perhaps the election in Peru coming up, and that perhaps the connection between the state of Venezuela and the state of Iran and even Hezbollah, which I hear crops up every once in a while in a Bolivian context or even a Peruvian context.
Will, that sounds like a national defense question.
Yeah, I mean, we obviously have very significant concerns, and I think that the clearest statement of them is the fact that Venezuela is decertified in the U.S. government system as being fundamentally non-cooperative. In our efforts, that tends to happen when there are not the situation I was referring to before, when folks are overwhelmed by a problem, but when folks are part of the problem themselves.
Does that answer your question?
Perhaps as much as you could say.
I mean, I think that Venezuela gives a lot of aid to these other countries, I think, but it's often going. I don't know that it's related to organized crime as much as sort of propping up populist movements. Or now, in some cases, though, Nicaragua is a very worrying case for me. And I think, to the extent that Chavez is propping up that regime, which is becoming increasingly authoritarian, if not already. I mean, they've sort of had a coup of their own by judicial decree. So I think that's concerning. I don't know how that plays into the organized crime issue. I'm not so sure yet.
Let's continue our menu of frustrations. He's in the back.
Paula Kling from Semana News Magazine in Colombia. You all commented on the strong leadership of Uribe. I just wanted to know about post-Uribe, like following on the gentleman's question about weak institutions that might be left behind, any vacuums that you might leave behind, like a post-Uribe Colombia.
I don't know whether to say we hope we get somebody as good as Uribe or as bad, but have you?
Well, I think the main the main interest of the United States is to ensure that the working relationship that we've developed is one that's between countries and will continue no matter what the situation. I think when President, I'll just defer to what President Obama said when he met with Uribe and commented clearly on the position of the U.S. government for a progress that follows constitutional norms.
Hi, Carrie McDonald of the Council on Foreign Relations. We speak frequently of whole government approaches and the need for not just military and political approaches, but also socioeconomic approaches, the question about the young male population. And Will, you mentioned both the demand side as well as the supply side and the importance of that. To what degree in the U.S. government today is there an integration of the domestic policy discussion of addressing drug use in America, the demand problem, with the strategies in our foreign affairs and our national security apparatus to deal in a whole of government way? And then very quickly, I'm wondering, in the nexus between organized crime and other illicit activities, what evidence have we seen of the nexus between organized crime and proliferation of nuclear materials and technologies?
Yeah, I just say that our drug czar, Kurilkowski, is very much focused on exactly what you're talking about bringing both the supply and the demand side of the U.S. government work together. And from what I've seen, I've been impressed with his focus on all of this. On the proliferation side, we definitely see criminal organizations involved in widespread weapons proliferation. On the nuclear side, in particular, we've seen there have been publicized reports, but I'm probably not going to go past that.
I mean, on the last part, I consider the AQCON network to have been an international criminal network in certain respects. It, it bore many of the indicia that international criminal groups bear in terms of, how it stored and moved money, how it moved people around and things of that sort, and how it used different jurisdictions to do that.
I don't know that it's appropriate to end this on the issue of the relationship between narcotics and nuclear weapons. But the time says I have to. So thank you all for coming.
Thank you for watching this Council on Foreign Relations video. For additional audio, video, and transcripts of CFR meetings, as well as expert analysis of international news, please visit us online at cfr.org.